السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. When Abdullah Aid says healing the Ummah, it means it. I've been with Abdullah Aid for many years now, and I've visited quite a few countries and seen the delivery of the aid. Your contributions. Tonight, you've already contributed by merely purchasing a ticket. So I want to thank you for that. And I want to let you know that Abdullah Aid is serious when it comes to delivering your aid to the rest of the Ummah that is bleeding. I've been to areas where I've witnessed the bleeding of members of the Ummah. And I've been in pain, but comforted by the fact that I know you would reach out because you feel part of the Ummah. So when we say healing the Ummah, who exactly is the Ummah? The Ummah are those who share a statement and believe it. That statement is La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. There is none worthy of worship besides Allah, and Muhammad, peace be upon him, is his messenger. The minute a person declares this, they become a member of the Ummah, my brother, my sister. The feeling for entire humanity is there. In fact, the feeling for all the creatures of Allah is there, including the birds, the dogs, the pigs, the cows, the sheep, the goats, the insects, the ants. We definitely are taught to be kind to all animals. More than animals, we're taught to be kind to humankind. When the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, tells us that whoever doesn't show mercy will not be shown mercy. And in another narration, Allah Almighty is letting us know through the blessed lips of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that those who have mercy upon those on earth, the one in the skies or in the heaven will have mercy on them. To be honest with you, it shows us how important it is to help heal everyone. But members of the Ummah hold a special place in the hearts of fellow members of the Ummah. So when I see my brothers and sisters in pain in Palestine, I am in pain. I don't believe that there is a Muslim who is not in pain to witness the genocide, the atrocities, the unacceptable acts of aggression perpetrated against our brothers and sisters in Palestine. I don't believe there is a Muslim who is not hurt by that. I don't believe there is a Muslim who does not feel that something needs to be done, but each one of us has a different capacity. Rather than playing a blame game that Shaitan wants us to play by looking at each other and thinking this guy could have done more and should have done more, without realizing the other fingers are actually pointing back at you to say, you do what you can and leave the others to do what they can based on their understanding, their capacity, and so on. If you want to encourage others, then do so. That's the reason why we have tonight. But don't point fingers in a way that you're creating a bigger problem in the Ummah. I know that every single one of you cares for Palestine. And I know that you don't only care for Palestine, but rather for a list of names of countries that sometimes is exhausting. And sometimes places within countries that are generally peaceful without a problem people would suspect. But there are pockets of people within nations that are sometimes advanced. Even within the UK, there are people struggling and suffering as I'm speaking. Am I not right? What are you doing for them? The reality is I may not be able to do that much for them, but I have two guarantees. The first guarantee is I will not harm them, which means the pain they have is not going to come from me. Pause for a moment before we get to the second guarantee and ask yourself, do I cause pain in the life of anyone else? If the answer is yes, then you have a lot of work to do. Do you cause pain to someone else? Perhaps someone living with you, someone working with you, someone above you, below you, in authority, in financial standing, or whatever else it may be. Do you hurt people? Do you cause pain? Well, I can tell you what, if you cause pain, pain shall be caused upon you or to you as well. It will come back at some point. It's the promise of Allah. You do and it shall be done. If not today, then after 10 years. So what's the way out? Because I've given the punch and I'm expecting a punch after 10 years, perhaps a bigger punch. But now I regret before being punched. What should I do? Well, I need to make amends by seeking the forgiveness of Allah, by reaching out to the person if I can and saying I'm sorry. And sometimes if you're too shy to say I'm sorry for what I did, you can just say, Salaam alaikum, you know we're going for Umrah, please forgive me for everything I said or did that may have hurt you or caused pain. And so it's a general blanket seeking of forgiveness. It could happen. And sometimes you may not have access to that person. That's the worst type of harm you could have inflicted another. When you don't even have access to the person, you barely know them. In the age of social media, this is happening a lot, where you said something, you retweeted something, you reposted something that was hurtful and harmful against a person you don't even know. You may never, ever know in your life. How are you going to make amends with that type of a person when you don't even know them, you don't have access to them, but you have a debt that you owe them, basically? That's very dangerous. So in this day and age, more and more people are losing their good deeds or swerving towards the devil just by simple tappings on their phone, sitting at night, sometimes in the comfort of their bedding, half asleep, and they're busy retweeting, saying things to crack a joke about someone that's going to hurt them so badly or to pass negative information. When that happens, you may have to resort to praying for them, asking Allah to forgive them, asking Allah to bless them, give a charity on their behalf, do a good deed maybe on their behalf, and ask Allah to forgive you as well for what you did, and then undo what you did to the best of your capacity. Best of your capacity means, what exactly did you say? What exactly did you do? Okay, you don't have access to them, so are you prepared to say good things? Are you prepared to clarify in public, or at least start reversing what you did? In that particular instance, you would be from among those who is conscious about not inflicting pain on others. What's the point of talking about the pain of the ummah in order to help it heal when you are the one causing pain to your own daughter-in-law, to your mother-in-law perhaps? And mothers-in-law are lovely people, by the way. It's just that sometimes there's a stigma attached to that name. And therefore, as soon as we enter the territory where we now have a mother-in-law, we have public enemy number one, just by virtue of them having the title. It's not fair. I know some amazing mothers-in-law. By the way, I'm a father-in-law. So you can imagine. You can imagine. It doesn't make people bad, but do you inflict pain on them by what you say, by what you do, or the other way around, or your own children, or your parents, or whoever else it may be? Today is the day. You want to heal the ummah, stop the pain. The ummah will heal. It will begin to heal by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that was the first guarantee you have is, I will not harm you. The first guarantee is, I'm not going to be able to harm, meaning you won't be harmed from me, not me. The second guarantee is my brother, my sister, no matter who you are and where you are, I will try my best to assist you. Given the capacity Allah has given me, I'm going to try my best to help you. That's my guarantee. You're a random person. To me, you're a member of the ummah. I care for you. We might not talk to each other. You might pass, I might pass. But I tell you, if something happens to you and I know about it, and I'm present or even in my absence, I've heard about it, wallahi, it's going to pain me, number one. Number two, I'll be the first one to rush to your assistance by the will of Allah. Because you're closer to me than the rest of humankind. Although if it happened to any human being, I would still be hurt and I would still try to reach out. But you're even closer. Like your own child, when something happens to them, you reach out to them more than you would other people's children. May Allah help us. So these are some of the stepping stones towards seeing the ummah heal. I told you the ummah are those who've uttered the statement. And then the ummah, what happens is shaitan comes to us and makes us think that, you know what, this person believes slightly differently from you. This person has a sheikh who's like this, and that person goes to that mosque, and this person goes to this masjid, and that person sits in that halaqah. So therefore we are different, and they create segments in order to fragment us to the degree that the ummah can never heal. Wallahi, if we were united, our brothers and sisters would never have suffered in Palestine the way they did. It wouldn't have happened. If we were all together as an ummah, the mere fact that we have 2 billion people, nobody would dare touch anyone. But the fact that they know we are fragmented, or they make it their business to fragment us in some cases, they know these people are weak. Slap one, the others will just look on and say, Astaghfirullah, if they care, and Alhamdulillah, if they don't. How many times have people in the ummah been hurt? And because you didn't get along with them, you said, mashallah, they deserved it. Am I right? Am I right? See, the yeses came from you. I thought you'd have kept quiet even the second time. But the fact that you said yes, you know what I'm going on about. We need to heal. We need to help heal. It's okay. Even though I have a difference with you, I'm not going to pray for your downfall. Or I'm not going to pray when you get hurt and thank Allah. But rather I'm going to say, oh Allah, I have a difference. Help squash it. Help eradicate it. Help bring us closer together. Help resolve our matters. That's healing the ummah. Do you think healing the ummah is when I don't get along with you, I'm excited about you being hurt by a third party? That will not heal the ummah. Because then when you are hurt, the same third party will also be excited. How did you heal the ummah? At Abdullah Aid, we don't differentiate between the people. We help anyone and everyone who needs that help. If they need the help, we are there. If we can and we know about it, we're able and capable, and it's within whatever we've set out to do, it is done by the will of Allah, within our capacity. And this reflects the true believer, who is supposed to be concerned about solving problems, helping people, assisting them heal, give them a better life, a better bedding, a better home, a better place to live and to eat and to educate themselves, provide them with better opportunities for their future. That's what Abdullah Aid is all about. We want to see the future brighter than what we are witnessing today. We feel embarrassed that there are people who are struggling in our midst, and there is very limited things that we can do for them. That's embarrassing. Unfortunately, we're in this situation. I would love to see an end to every war there is. But some might say that's just fantasy. I'm going to work towards it. I'm going to keep reminding people, you don't have to slap someone because you disagree with them. Be just, be fair. You have a difference. You may want to step back a little bit, but wish well for your brothers and sisters. Where's your heart? Where is your heart? I don't want to associate with you anymore because you've bitten me more than once. But low key, I'm going to pray that Allah bless you. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. That's amazing. Are you feeling what I'm feeling? I've seen people make mistakes online, public figures. And I've seen sheikhs and scholars say, that's the end. Cancel them. It's over. That's it. They cannot come up again. And I think differently. I'm a father. I'm a grandfather too. I think differently, and I think if this was my child, is it fair to cancel them because of 2 mistakes they've made? Let me reach out to this person and see what might have bothered them. Perhaps let me see how best I can bring them back on track. Wouldn't you like that for your child? If your child were on drugs, may Allah help all the children who are on drugs and the adults to come out of these bad habits. Let the ummah heal. Make dua for them. You see a child on drugs, you're quick to pass bad comments about the children of others who have an addiction, not realizing that if it were to happen to you, you would deal with it differently, and you would really not want others to comment negatively about your child who's addicted to something terrible. So can't you treat them like your own children? That's when the ummah will heal. So when I see someone, I'd like to work with them. You have your own child. Wouldn't you like people to give your child a chance? Wouldn't you like to take your child from one place to another to see how best they can be reintroduced or integrated back into society and community and attend the masjid and attend the talks and be a beautiful member of the community who will contribute positively to their families, communities, and build their akhirah in the process? We'd like to see that. So go easy on others. When you don't like someone, you can step back. You can step back. I don't need to associate with you, but guess what? I won't let that hate get to the degree that you've let it get to. You're not going to see me making public refutations about X, Y, and Z, because you know what? It's okay. I won't let the hate, as tempting as it is, get to the level that yours got to, because you're a member of the ummah. May Allah help this ummah heal. I want to have a heart made of gold where I can pray. That doesn't mean I'm not going to protect myself from harm. No. The hadith says a true believer is never bitten from the same source twice. Never. What that means, I'm bitten. I'm going to step back. I'm going to put a protection, a mechanism. I don't want to talk to you, actually. But I'm not going to harm you. I just don't want to talk to you. So if you're irritated by me not talking to you, thank Allah, I haven't raised my hands to say, oh Allah, destroy them. You know what happens in the ummah? Small things, and we say, oh Allah, get up for tahajjud and say, oh Allah, break them, destroy them, finish them. And you won't believe it. It's possible at the same moment, the same person is making the same dua at the same time to the same Lord against you in almost similar words. How is the ummah going to heal? If Allah had to give both of those people their dua, what's going to happen to us? I'm finished, they're finished. But Allah knows in His mercy, He only does what is fair and just. Someone asked me, you know, my mother curses me a lot. My beloved mothers and fathers, don't ever curse your children no matter what. Don't ever curse your children, even jokingly. Don't ever. When they do something that upsets you, don't curse them, because if that's a moment of acceptance of dua, you're dead. You rather say a good dua. You're a mother. You're a father. You're a relative. Don't say a bad dua. Your son or your daughter did something really nasty. Say, oh Allah, soften their heart. Bring them back. Let them understand. Let them realize. It might take 4 years for them to realize, but they'll come back after 4 years because of a dua you made 4 years back. But if you say, tum pe lanat ho, as they always say, what's that for? In Urdu, that means, you know, you're cursed. May the curse of Allah be on you. Why did you say that? You're cursing your own child. Do you know that your dua has value in the eyes of Allah? So anyway, the person asks that my mother curses me a lot. And I said, you know what? Allah says in the Quran, لَا يَحِيقُ الْمَكْرُ السَّيِّئُ إِلَّا بِأَهْلِهِ. The evil plot is not deserved by anyone besides who? Those who truly deserve it. If you don't deserve that curse, it's not going to come to you. It won't affect you. Even if it's your mother or your father, it will bother them, unfortunately, not you. So don't allow that to happen. We are trying to heal the ummah. Are you noticing how we're speaking international, but we're starting with the solution from our own hearts? Because if you don't have that heart, you're going to see the people suffer in Palestine and you're going to say, oh, those people are Sunnis and they belong to a certain sect and therefore we don't need to help them. What did you just say? What did you just say? The ummah needs to heal. Are they not members of the ummah? Are they not part of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah? I'm not downplaying differences of opinion we have. We will always have them. We will study. We will talk about it. We will discuss. We will provide evidence. We will learn. We will change wherever change is needed. But bottom line, they are members of the ummah. They are part of the ummah. I promise you they are. If someone tells you otherwise, they've brainwashed you. They are part of the ummah. That doesn't mean I agree with everything they did. They have entered the door. Now when we've entered the door, known as I am a part of the ummah, we have differences. We know the differences. But you can't take them out and say you're no longer part of the ummah just because of this difference and you have this sheikh and that sheikh. Be careful. Because these are some of the traps of shaitan, where shaitan wants us to be fragmented, because Allah says, وَلَا تَنَازَعُوا فَتَفْشَلُوا وَتَذْهَبَ رِيحُكُمْ. Do not dispute amongst yourselves, because you will be unsuccessful and you will lose your might. تَذْهَبَ رِيحُكُمْ. Your reeh, reeh is referring to the might, the power. Your might will be gone because you're disputing, fighting with one another. The Quran says that. So what's the solution? Immediately after that, Allah says, وَاصْبِرُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. Be patient. Allah is with those who bear patience. Be patient. Go easy. Go easy. Go easy on yourself. When? When you've done something wrong and you repent to Allah, be convinced He's forgiven you. Shaitan's trap is, he tries to say, no, He didn't forgive you. And you start thinking, what I did was so evil, I don't think Allah's going to forgive me. All those thoughts are the devil's plot. You committed a sin, I don't care what it is. You asked Allah's forgiveness, that is what's of importance. When you ask Allah's forgiveness, be convinced in your heart, Allah's forgiven me, let me move on. Allahu Akbar. You're a human. I draw comfort by the fact that Adam alayhi salam, the first of our species, was told by Allah not to do certain things. A few days ago, my son asks me, you know what? Someone asks, what's the reason that Allah created pigs if pigs are haram? Good question, right? Why is it haram? I said, Allah wants to test you addition and subtraction. That's a simple answer. That you know what? He'll do things that, okay, you can have this and you cannot have this. He wants to see, are you going to do this for my sake? And are you going to abstain from this for my sake? So He's testing you both sides. When you go to a mathematics test, they're not going to teach you, they're not going to ask you addition only, but division and subtraction is part of mathematics. Why do they teach you subtraction if you're, you know, if you're learning mathematics? Well, because you need to know it. Same applies. When Allah says something, do something, you get a reward for doing it. He wants to reward you for not doing something, so He tells you, right, I'm going to make certain things and I'm going to tell you don't do this. They're going to be there. You achieve a different joy spiritually when you abstain from things Allah's told you not to do. There is a different type of a blessing that you achieve. Growth of a different nature altogether. So subhanallah, Allah's made the pig not for you to be unkind or abusive or hurtful towards the pig, but rather to abstain respectfully. I'm not going to associate and eat the meat of and so on, but I'm not just going to go around and throw stones at pigs. Not at all. I'm not going to be unkind to the pigs. Not at all. So Allah Almighty wants us to do certain things and not to do certain things. That's the test. May Allah Almighty grant us goodness. In our lives, many times we have instances where there are things that we are not supposed to do that dangle right in front of us. So tempting. Allah says, I'll reward you when you don't do these things. So Shaitan, when you seek forgiveness, has a job. His job is to make you lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Allah tells you, don't lose hope in my mercy. I've forgiven you. So what do? You move on. I was saying, Adam alayhi salam, Allah told him not to eat from the tree. Anything else Allah told him not to do? Anyone knows anything else that Allah told Adam alayhi salam and Hawa not to do? Anyone? That was the main thing. And perhaps the only thing. Allah says, do whatever you want. Eat whatever you want. But don't eat from, don't go close to this tree. What did he do? What did he do? He ate from the tree. The only thing Allah told him not to do, that's what he did. We are the children of the same man. You follow? Allah tells you not to do things, you may end up doing it. Why did Allah choose that Adam alayhi salam would do the only thing that he was told not to do? Because Allah wanted to teach us a lesson that as soon as he did it, he regretted it. He realized Shaitan's trap. He sought forgiveness. And Allah says, I forgave him. I forgave him. So Allah says, now all of you, the children, which means all of us here, we want you to know that this is how we operate. If you end up doing something that's displeasing to Allah, regret it, seek the forgiveness, turn back to Allah, understand the plot of the devil, we forgive you. That's it. Gone. Wiped out. Don't lose hope. And inshallah, we grow in this way. You know, I could go on and on and on. But just in case, Brother Omar, just in case the internet still doesn't work, I'm going to steal a little bit of the time of the quiz. Is it okay? Are you sure? Yes. MashaAllah, I hear a loud yes on the right. The quiz is a very nice thing. It's really amazing. I enjoy it all the time. Should I still carry on? Okay, all right. There we go. So I tell you what, my beloved sisters and my brothers, we care. We care not just for Palestine, like I said, but there are people struggling in Sudan right now. Unbelievable what's happening there. Warfare, avoidable. But unfortunately, it's happened. It's taken Sudan to the Stone Age, if you know. Sudanese are embarrassed because they don't even believe what's going on in their own country. The same thing applies in so many other countries. We have then people who are struggling with disaster upon disaster, so much more. There are people who are struggling in Indonesia, people struggling in Afghanistan and in Pakistan, in parts of different countries, in Morocco, still the people who are affected by the earthquakes and the floods in Libya. Some places we have no access to. Some places we have no access to. It's either too dangerous or it's disallowed for us to work in those places. We won't be able to do it. We'll expect others who are able to do it on our behalf as an ummah. But to be honest with you, wherever we can, we reach out to them. Wouldn't you like to reach out to those who live with you? Goodness, a good word. I want to invite you to a beautiful invitation that would change your life. This is an invitation to tell you, my sisters, my brothers, promise that you're going to say at least 10 good sentences to those whom you live with every day. Promise that you're going to say 10 good sentences. Wow, mashallah, you're looking so good today. Who did you say it to? Your own spouse. They'll probably say, you've never said that to me in 20 years. What happened today? They're waiting to heal. Those are statements that will help them heal. It will bring your family together. It will bring your relative. When we have negatives, we always say it. When we have positives, we keep it in. We won't help the ummah heal. We make the promise? Sisters have all said yes. The brothers are just looking at me. We make the promise? How many good sentences? 10. Okay. Did you hear that? Inshallah, 10 good sentences every day to those whom you live with, whoever they may be, your children, your in-laws, your outlaws, whoever they are, inshallah. You say some good words to them, good sentences. You know, mashallah, I'm so happy, you know, and so whatever, you know what it is, right? And the I love yous and so on need to go to the right people, by the way. Because if you're living in with your not so halal person, then you need to know that those sentences don't really apply. But nonetheless, what I want to say to you is, if it's not 10, at least start with a few. By the will of Allah, it will change your life. I guarantee you. Why? In some of the therapy sessions that I have, I've always suggested this type of thing. And I try to follow up later and say, did you do this? And when they ultimately say, well, now I started it, since you asked me 3-4 times. Initially, they don't like to start it. Every single one of them says it has had a positive impact. Some say unimaginable, unbelievable, and some admit that at least it's positive. You have to say a good thing. Come on, who are they going to hear it from? Your children. Some fathers are such that they've never told their daughters, mashallah, you're looking so beautiful. You know that? I love just looking at you, man. They've never said it to their daughters. And when I told one elderly man, you've got to say it, he says, no, not my generation. I said, but Allah's kept you alive in this generation, so you got to do it for them. Because uncle, if they don't hear you saying it, you know what? The similar uncle next door is saying it every day. May Allah forgive us. So inshallah, we help the ummah heal by starting with our families. And then it grows. You don't realize that today you've actually helped people in need in places you may not know. How? By merely buying a ticket to come to this venue. I know you're probably going to have food and whatever else that might even go beyond an amount you may have given or just about there. Nonetheless, you've supported the cause in a huge way. So I want to thank you for attending this evening and for literally sitting with us and for listening, checking. You can pass the word to others and you can also reach into your pockets or your phones. You know, nowadays we no longer have pockets, we have everything on the phone. And you can give a little bit to our brothers and sisters who are struggling. It will also help them heal. And with that healing, we've spoken about a few other pointers that would also allow this ummah to heal by the will of Allah. Remember, your heart is a human heart. It's not an angel. You're a human. You have feelings. You feel hurt at times. You feel let down at times. But try to empower others. I get the energy. Whenever I have to stand up to empower others, I forget about everything happening to me. And that's the reason why I think I'm quite a forgiving person. I wouldn't mind. Someone messaged me, say, please forgive me, I said something bad about you. I replied saying, forgiven. And by the way, if you ever need to say something bad about me again, you can do it. They must have been shocked. Why? Because you know what? You don't butter my bread in the least. Nothing of what you say or do even bothers me. It actually would bother you, not me. I know what I'm doing, and I know why I'm doing it. Your validation or the lack of it doesn't really bother me. So don't worry. You might not have that particular level because I'm a public figure. I get bashed. And I look at it and I feel sorry for the people doing the bashing. Because if they knew what we're busy doing while they're bashing, they would actually be jealous. Say, it's okay. But you're not public figures. And some of you might be. But most of you are probably not public figures. So you don't know how it feels to be bashed. And you don't know how it feels sometimes to have people say very negative things about you. The little that you might be going through, trust me, it's very forgivable. You just have to find it in your heart. It's okay. If it's really bothering you and your life, it might be a little bit different. But don't ever deal with it in a way that will cause more pain in the situation. May Allah Almighty grant us a good healing. I've spoken for half an hour. I've added about 10 minutes, mashallah. May Allah Almighty bless you all. I've really enjoyed this evening so much. I think it's the warmth of the company. The brothers doing the sound, I want to thank you. The brothers of the venue, I really want to appreciate it. Remember, if the internet didn't work in this particular place, there must be a good reason for it. I'm not going to add more pain to my heart to start thinking negative things, but I am going to say, alhamdulillah, at least we've got a few more minutes squeezed in of my talk. جزاكم الله خير أقول قولي هذا السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته